Man, it's been a long news week. Time to unwind with a little Facebook.
Facebook continues to be under fire for failing to crack down on fake news. It's been called a haven for fake news.
Russian trolls use Facebook to exploit racial tension.
Did you fall for propaganda from a Russian troll?
Ah, Jesus. Facebook is dead. YouTube.
YouTube is the latest social media company under the microscope.
Ads running on YouTube channels that promote white nationalism.
Trending tab featured a conspiracy video that attacked survivors of the Parkland shooting.
God, never mind. Time for thirst traps on Instagram.
Russian bot ads appeared on Instagram.
Thousands of ads posted on Instagram meant to divide Americans.
Okay, that's it. I'm going back to my true safe space. The one place where nobody can hurt me. Pinterest. Oh my God, what happened to Pinterest? There's nowhere to go anymore. Every social media site has become a dumpster fire. Why is this happening? What's turning all these sites into fever swamps? Ah, crap, it's me, isn't it?
Tech's biggest companies are once again the platform for conspiracy theories, hate speech,
fake news,
forcing both YouTube and Facebook to apologize.
That was a big mistake, and I'm sorry.
Executives admitted their limitations, but promised they will do a better job.
Let's start at the OG misinformation platform. No.
Friendster?
No.
Manhunt?
What? No, the human brain.
Humans are social animals at their root, and they're constantly looking for reinforcement signals or signals that we belong.
Jay Van Babel researches what kinds of information humans respond to on social media. Van Babel did a study last year tracking what kinds of tweets were more likely to go viral when it came to divisive issues like gun control. And he found that tweets that used moral emotional words, words like blame, hate, and shame, were way more likely to be retweeted than tweets with neutral language.
One of the reasons we think this is happening is because when you're using that type of tribal language, it sends a signal about who you are, what you care about, and what group you belong to.
This makes sense if you think about it. If you're trying to signal to others that you're a real Ariana Grande fan, you don't say, "I personally enjoy Ariana's music." You say, "Ariana Grande is the best singer of all time. Anyone who disagrees is an idiot." You know, like, hypothetically.
Are you playing with imaginary hair?
That tribal desire to organize into us versus them is a basic part of human nature. It's why we have hardcore nerd fandoms.
I am a Gryffindor!
And lose our minds at sports games.
Yankees suck!
But when it comes to politics, that desire can push us towards some extreme views.
One hypothesis is that when people are sharing the most extreme forms of political content, that sends the strongest, clearest signal about what their identity is, and it signals very clearly who the outgroup is.
You can see that tendency when you look at which US senators have the most Facebook followers. The further left or right, the more followers. When we rally around these politicians, it leaves no doubt about which tribe we belong to.
If they're sending information that's moderate, it doesn't clearly signify who their in-group and out-group is. And so there is this incentive structure potentially to share more and more extreme information to signal more and more clearly who you are and who you affiliate with.
But these loud signals of our group status are way easier to do online than in person. And that's because in the real world, there are social costs to being a jerk.
So normally when we're talking about things like politics with our friends at the bar or with our family at Thanksgiving, we have social checks in place that send us signals that maybe this isn't landing well with everybody. Maybe it's resonating with your sister or your brother, but your mom and dad are giving you the stink eye. We get these signals all the time from people that we're excluding them or that we're rubbing them the wrong way. And if we value those relationships, we tend to tone down our language.
And this is where the problem with social media starts. Platforms like Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter, they're designed to do one thing: keep you on the site for as long as possible. The more time you spend on the site, the more commercials, sidebar ads, and promoted tweets they can show you, the more money they make.
If your goal is to get the greatest amount of engagement with an audience, you need content that's gonna be addictive. In terms of politics and news, stories that are laden with emotion, connect to our identities, and is morally arousing are the types of stories that are gonna get people engaged the most.
The problem is, getting the stink eye is a really unpleasant experience. We don't like being told that we've crossed a line or gone too far. And we are less likely to stay on a website that makes us feel that way. So social media sites have been designed to protect us from stink eye. To cater to our tribal nature by figuring out what we like and showing us more of it.
By identifying what products and people and politicians you like, they can identify with some degree of certainty what your politics are and then feed you back more and more information that confirms those beliefs.
It's not just algorithms doing this. These websites invite us to sort ourselves into tribes. We get to follow and subscribe to people we agree with, block sources of information we don't like, and literally join groups of people who think the same way we do.
You get content that confirms your beliefs and doesn't challenge you, and then it's a dissonance-free environment. You don't have to face up to individuals and people who disagree with you.
Dissonance-free environment is a fancy way of saying a place where you don't get stink eye. That study about how polarizing tweets got more engagement, it also found that those tweets rarely left our echo chambers. We're getting tons of positive feedback from people who already agree with us. And all that positive feedback can push us further to the extreme.
If I share some extreme political content and it gets a lot of likes, I realize, because I've been reinforced, that that's what people on my social network like, or that's what's more likely to go viral. And then I might try to match it or make my next post even more extreme to get more reinforcement.
And if you're looking for something more extreme to share, these platforms will help you find it. Watch a few anti-immigrant videos.
This is totally out of control.
And YouTube's algorithm will start recommending videos about white genocide. Join a few pro-Trump groups, and your Facebook feed will fill up with smear campaigns and conspiracy theories.
The 9/11 attacks themselves were orchestrated by the Bush administration.
Even search for information about vaccines on Pinterest, and your homepage will be full of anti-vaxxer bullshit.
And so you can see people potentially being led down this pathway of more and more extreme posts. There's a social reinforcement system that would otherwise take a long time through lots of interactions with people in our community that can now be done very rapidly and at an enormous scale.
All of this makes social media sites gold mines for con artists, conspiracy theorists, and trolls who exploit our tribal mentality to get clicks and views.
Anybody can write a blog, however incendiary, and if it has a catchy title or catchy content, people are gonna share it.
Kaepernick is an attention-seeking crybaby who takes out his perceived oppression on the flag and national anthem. I stand for our service members, our veterans, our Leos, and our first responders, not for the indulgent a-hole who disrespects them. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram.
It's a terrifyingly effective strategy. A 2016 Democratic strategist said that when it came to which kinds of ads perform best on Facebook, ugly and incendiary won every time.
The real tough laugh if you say you are a liberal. Trump train moving ahead full steam. It ain't too late.
The same is true for conspiracy theories and fake news stories. One study looked at 10 years of true and false stories on Twitter. The authors measured what they called retweet cascades, chain reactions where the original story is shared and retweeted to a much larger audience. And when they compared the cascades of real stories and fake stories, the fake ones reached thousands more people. And it didn't matter that these stories were coming from small accounts. Anybody could go viral if the story triggered enough of a tribal response. In 2016, it was teenagers in Macedonia making thousands of dollars publishing fake election news on Facebook. After the Parkland shooting, it was random YouTubers going viral by accusing students of being crisis actors. The Russian trolls messing with our elections, they're not super hackers. They're people posting low quality, highly emotional content that they know will go viral.
The Russian playbook exposed the architectural flaws in products like Facebook, Instagram, YouTube. Anybody can run that playbook.
So far, social media companies have responded to this by trying to punish bad actors.
Facebook has suspended hundreds of pages tied to a Russian group.
Social media companies are banning Alex Jones.
Twitter has banned Milo Yiannopoulos.
But punishing individual bad actors doesn't change the incentives that brought them to the platform in the first place. One fake news writer told the Washington Post that if Facebook cracked down on his content, I would try different things. I have at least 10 sites right now. If they crack down on a couple, I'll just use others.
And this is why getting rid of Alex Jones, if you ban him, someone else will realize they can get rich pushing the same type of agenda for a period of time. Followers, clicks, advertisers, speaking fees, and other opportunities that are incredibly lucrative.
The problem with social media isn't that a few bad apples are ruining the fun. It's that these sites are designed to reward bad apples. And until these companies decide that there's something more important than getting people to watch ads, we're gonna keep seeing the worst of human nature reflected back at us.
All right, that's good, thank you.
I'm starting to feel passionate about my point of view.